through the carbonate, that's how I got free. Jabba back off because there's no stopping me. Postmodern player, sample-tastic, flows ekphrastic, I get drastic. Hey, watch the plastic, yo, I name check and leave.
Welcome to the MacGuffin, episode 196. I'm Spencer.
I'm Greg.
Today we're going to give you our DVD rundown for the week of October 16th.
Yes, indeed.
Kind of a week, but you know, there's some decent stuff for those who are so inclined.
At least it's not the middle of summer. That was just those were harsh doldrums, weeks. Seriously. I'm glad that at least now we might have some interesting other ones, but we usually at least have one good headliner a week. That's nice. We didn't have that for a couple months later.
Yeah, and you know, in terms of like the actual quality of the film, some of them are good quality. It's just the releases are kind of meh.
Yes.
Speaking of which, the first one I'm going to talk about is Moonrise Kingdom, Wes Anderson's new film that came out this year, one that you're a big fan of.
Yes, loved it. Loved it. Was...
Unfortunately, you know, this release does not live up to the quality of the film. I mean, in terms of his career, some people, I don't know, you might argue, this is a bit of a resurgence after... Mm-hmm. The last couple films were being
Darjeeling.
Yeah, exactly, and, yeah. Darjeeling. So it's a bit of a pickup again. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, it's unfortunate. Let's see, in terms of special features, there's a look inside Moonrise Kingdom. There's a trip around the island of Penzance, mm-hmm. Which features Bruce Willis, Edward Norton, Bill Murray, and Wes Anderson, amongst others.
Okay.
Touring the locations from the set and stuff like that. Mm. And then there's a set tour with Bill Murray. And that's literally it.
Wow.
Like, those are all the special features.
I mean, now granted, you know, Criterion picks movies that are already hits and puts them on Criterion releases, but considering this guy's had Criterion releases for some of his movies that have been gigantic, it's kind of sad to see a movie that we even did well, from what I remember correctly, got good reviews. I don't know how well it did box office, but I assume well enough.
Yeah, I mean...
It's kind of sad that it would be so lackluster.
I will give him credit for giving the Blu-ray, DVD, digital copy, ultraviolet all in one. So that's pretty cool.
At least you got that going for you.
If you're like a hardcore fan of the movie, maybe you buy it. But I would say I'd hold out and wait and see if there's another edition, you know, say Criterion or whomever.
Yeah. Or like some Wes Anderson collection that comes out.
It just feels like there's got to be something more coming because three special features is pretty blasé.
Yeah. I almost feel like, putting the combo packs is the new special feature where people are put the money into that rather than putting the stuff into making the film have extras.
That's a fair point. And you know, I would like more about like say the kids for instance, because that's a huge part of the movie, filming with kids.
I watched like 40 minutes worth of YouTube videos of interviews this one guy did with a bunch of different cast members, and the kids were great.
Just put it on. Put that on there.
There was amazing seeing what they did and their thought process because I remember when we first talked about this movie, that was one of the things we were most curious about was how much the kids were going to enter into it, and they did fantastically. So I would really love to hear their perspective. That, yeah. So
let's move on though. Probably a much more successful movie, but not necessarily in terms of quality. Madagascar 3, Europe's Most Wanted is coming out.
Circus Afro.
In a 3-disc Blu-ray, 3D Blu-ray, DVD, digital copy, plus ultraviolet. So
Jesus. You have
all five bases covered with this puppy. Yeah.
You know why that is, right? Because they know that only six people are going to buy Madagascar, so they have to put the biggest package they can so they can make as much money.
Millions are going to buy it.
I know, sadly.
Madagascar made probably like $400 million.
The third one?
Oh, I'm sure. They always do. Like, these things are super successful. That's why they keep pumping them out. Ugh. And, you know...
Not that much. The difference between the first one and the second one's success, though, is an interesting percentage margin.
I don't know. I still think it's going to make a ton of money. But the one thing I will say, though, in its defense, in terms of things that I see on Blu-ray and I'm most impressed with, animation tends to be one of them.
It's true. It is one of the things that's easiest to tweak the whole look on.
And it really... benefits from strong color palettes and stuff like that, which HD really helps.
The smooth lines and strong colors, it's like with animation, that's pretty much what your whole field's made out of. Totally.
One of the interesting notes that I could not believe, but I'm going to throw out there, by the way, Alan gave this a C+, for those of you who are wondering. One of the writers...
Thank you, Alan.
Noah Baumbach.
What?
Yeah. Yeah.
What?
Not only did I see that on Amazon and go, what? But I actually went to IMDb.
You like clicked to make sure it wasn't a different Noah Baumbach.
Yeah, I went to IMDb.
Not Noah with two H's.
Specifically to verify that it was the same one. Wow. Sure enough. go from one Wes Anderson connection to the next.
Wow.
Yeah.
I hope he was like the Damon Lindelof approach in movies where like they've gone through six drafts and like, God, we gotta get somebody who at least maybe knows what they're doing to clean it up. They brought him in, he like changed two jokes.
If
and then
this is cleaning it up, I'm a little bit worried. I'm more taking the approach of I hope they paid him a shit ton of money and he can do whatever he wants after that.
I did say that, and you know, Damon Lindelof wrote the script for Prometheus, which I didn't like.
He came in after the fact, and that's what
I'm referring to.
Have you seen the stuff about the original draft, which is like getting tremendous praise on the internet?
Oh.
We'll not go into that. That's a whole other discussion. Yeah. But
I'm just saying, people coming in and writing, not necessarily always a good thing.
But, you know, in terms of the releases this week, this is probably the most extensive special features available. Mm. Like, the DVD has a featurette about the cast, which is gigantic, with Ben Stiller, Jada Pinkett Smith, Chris Rock, David Schwimmer, Sacha Baron Cohen.
Animated films, as it grows, the cast grows too.
There's a featurette on the DVD with the commentary from the filmmakers, which I'd be curious to listen to. There is on the Blu-ray one about the animators, which I'd be very curious to see because I love hearing from the animators of films like this. And then there's a trivia track too, which, you know, maybe I don't like the trivia this is for, but for someone who liked the movie, it's probably pretty cool. You know,
trivia track. Are really interesting, even for movies that you don't care about sometimes.
Totally.
Because it's, you know, there's subtitles, and you sit there and you ignore the movie, and then you're just like, oh my God. Totally. Really?
If anything, maybe that'll make this interesting for us.
Sound was made by throwing a baboon against another baboon?
Yeah.
Weird.
Yeah. So maybe that's the key to making this interesting to you and me. I don't know.
Yeah, probably. So. Well, what we'll do is we'll just take the trivia track out, and we'll just watch that without the movie.
Sure. Okay. I'm game for that.
Yeah.
Let's move on, though, to one of the other sort of significant releases. And actually, this week, we're kind of looking at pretty much everything from this year, strangely enough.
Yeah, we're finally to that point where all the big shot releases are...
I wouldn't call these big shot releases, but the next one we're talking about is Chernobyl Diaries. The
big shot releases.
The horror film produced by Oren Peli from Paranormal Activity. Not director, not a writer, but, you know,
just
nevertheless.
Put money and said, hey, you creative people, I like what you're doing. You should do more of it.
It's sort of that same sort of found footage type film set in Chernobyl about a group of... I forget what it is, some sort of like, they have some hardcore tourism name for it. I forget.
Idiots. That's what they are.
But, you know, they go to Chernobyl. Sure enough, something starts
creepy
picking them off.
Going on.
And horror hijinks ensue.
I just want to know who leaves the Chernobyl diary.
That's a good question. Bum, bum,
maybe
bum.
The bad guy? Bad guy probably lives. It's a horror movie.
I think the bad guy's like mutants from Chernobyl, but you know, whatever, you know, if they're really into creative.
I would be like one really old mutant from when it happened.
I would like,
that's like writing a fucked up
diary.
What
I'm saying. I would love to see that action diary. Today my finger fell off.
I would love a movie that had a weird disembodied narrator that you not see to be revealed as the final moments of the film. That would be kind of cool if it cuts some weird mutated person writing in blood or something. Yeah.
Again, you know, Blu-ray, DVD, digital copy, ultraviolet digital copy.
Mm-hmm.
But special features, very lean. Though I kind of think they're funny, the ones that they do have.
Okay.
They have Uri's Extreme Tours infomercial. So
fake
extreme tours, maybe that's what they call it.
Probably.
So a fake tourism commercial, which I think is kind of a funny thing to
do. Some tongue-in-cheek to their own property.
Chernobyl conspiracy viral video. So presumably some sort of faux conspiracy theory video, you know, like
found
somebody
footage-y
did
thing.
YouTube. Somebody puts on YouTube that people do and stuff like that. And then there's an additional scene. Literally written single case. Scene. Not scenes, scene. So
I hope that additional scene is like 12 seconds long and it's like something completely minor.
I'm hoping it's like 45 minutes. It's just one really, really long ass scene.
One reel?
Yeah.
An entire
reel. It's like, you know, what's it called? Cloverfield.
Yes.
Where it's just no cuts for 45 minutes and that's it. But, you know, that's it. You know, if you like the movie or you're really hardcore Scare fan, perhaps this is worth checking out. But I'd probably wait and rent it from Scarecrow or stream it on Netflix.
Come rent it.
Inevitably when it comes there. Yeah.
It'll be cheap. You'll get it for a week or a while.
Yeah, I wouldn't invest too much money. I know Ben reviewed it and was not overly kind of it. It's one of those films that they screen like the day before at 8 p.m.
Yes.
before it's released.
And it's like the first people that ever get to hear about it, like first like
well,
pre-screenings,
it's sort of
like
the
day before.
They leave you as little time as possible for word to leak out. I mean, I guess at least they screened it. It screens. Some stuff doesn't even screen.
It's true.
So,
Ugh.
finally, we're going to end on a high-low note. depends on your perspective. And we're going with Alcatraz, the complete series. Yes, this is the canceled show on Fox from J.J. Abrams.
Oh.
About a group of...
How long did it make it?
Probably 13 episodes, okay. I would guess. A group of investigators who try and figure out why all the prisoners from Alcatraz disappeared and are suddenly reappearing in modern times. It's got, you know, it's got some good people. Sam Neill, for instance. Interesting. Jorge Garcia from Lost is on there.
Oh, that's right. Okay.
Hurley? I think... Yeah. He's on it. Not as Hurley, though.
But I mean...
That'd be a trip.
Yeah.
This is one of those shows that I think in the past, say, decade, this is one of the premises that intrigued me the most when I heard it. I was like, J.J. Abrams, Mystery Alcatraz. I was like, this sounds like a fucking slam dunk. Like, how can this go wrong? And I'll tell you what went wrong.
Fox.
Yeah, that's problem number one. But also, of all of J.J. Abrams' shows, this is one of the least... Or was it most serialized shows, and that each episode was fairly self-contained?
Okay.
And the overarching plot was not like really as much as, say...
sprinkled together?
Yeah, like, it's not really as cohesive as, say, like, Fringe or Lost or something like that. Or Alias.
All right.
It really felt like they're like, oh yeah, by the way, there's this... people coming back. Like, it was essentially sort of like a Law and Order type thing, where at the end they'd throw in like, oh yeah, by the way, he came back too. We're throwing him in jail with all the rest of the people that came back. And so it really never really clicked the same way those other shows did. The whole conspiracy angle was really interesting. Fortunately, left really pretty much unresolved. But like, that... I had such high hopes for it. And I feel like it could have been great. But yeah, it never really was able to give... it the chance that it deserved.
I kind of think that there's still to this day Lost backlash, that, and so when J.J. Abrams tosses his name on something that's mysterious,
he's had some trouble. Fringe has fought for a while to keep going,
but yeah, I think a lot of people are not on board if it seems that things are going to go the Lost direction rather than maybe like now the Fringe direction. Would be an example.
No, it's totally a valid concern. And, you know, I mean, this and Terra Nova are two shows I thought had a lot of potential that really weren't given proper opportunity to explore it. So,
yeah,
poor one out for both of them. But in terms of special features, you can tell they're just like dumping this. I mean, there's a gag reel, there's some deleted scenes, and then there's a featurette called The Allure of Alcatraz, where fans will discover what attracted the creators to this island. And they, as cast members, discuss their roles and share their memories from working on Alcatraz. And, you know, it's just a dump release, sadly. Like, I would check it out because it's kind of interesting, but, you know, it's really... I can't see why they would invest a lot of money in a show that's not coming back, so it's clearly being dumped. So, that's it for this week. Join us for our next episode when we talk about William H. Macy in honor of The Sessions.
Yes.
And as always, you can find us at MacGuffinPodcast.com, Twitter.com/MacGuffinCast, Facebook.com/MacGuffinPodcast, phone number 323-761-9842. We're on iTunes, Miro, Roku, Blip. Check in.
Get glue.
And we will see you next time. T-1000 can't stop me. I'm on fire tonight. Magneto can't stop me. I'm on fire tonight. Even Zod can't stop me. I'm on fire tonight. It's tight. Don't even try to buy the same style. Mr. Spock can't stop me. I'm on fire tonight. The Wrath of Khan can't stop me. I'm on fire tonight. The Borg can't stop me. I'm on fire tonight. Because I've got space game and it feels alright.